White House poster. This 22 by 28 inch pen and ink drawing attractively depicts C-SPAN's grassroots approach to the campaign. Call toll free 1-800-346-8800 for your subscription to the C-SPAN update and the Road to the White House poster.
Up next here on C-SPAN, our look ahead to tomorrow's presidential primary to be held in New York continues. On Sunday, all three active candidates for the Democratic presidential nomination took part in a forum sponsored by WNBC-TV.
Good morning. It seems likely that one of four men will be the next president of the United States, and three of them are sitting right here for this special one-hour edition of News Forum, a debate on the issues among the three contenders for the Democratic nomination for president. Michael Dukakis, the governor of Massachusetts, Senator Albert Gore of Tennessee, and the Reverend Jesse Jackson of South Carolina and Illinois. Gentlemen, I'd like to conduct this as a free flowing discussion, questions, and reasonably brief answers, but no filibusters. I have a stopwatch here, and if necessary, I'll invoke time limits in the interest of covering as much ground as we can and of being fair to all the participants. You may comment briefly on what the other candidates are saying, and at the end, in an order already predetermined by lot, we'll ask each of you for a brief closing statement, a last word to the voters of New York in this, the last debate of the New York primary. Gentlemen, Governor Dukakis, you're the son of Greek immigrant parents. Senator Gore, you were born into an old political family of Tennessee. Reverend Jackson, you were born to an unwed teenage mother. How do you believe your childhood, your early experiences in your life, as you see it, influence the course of your lives so that you wind up here at this time, in this place, running for President of the United States? Governor Dukakis?
Well, I'd say in two very basic ways, Gabe. My parents came here as immigrants, and I must have heard thousands of times that this was a great country, a land of opportunity, and that their sons had a very special opportunity to get an education, to do well, to work hard, and more than that, to contribute something to the country that had opened up its arms and its doors to my parents. I heard from my parents, much has been given to you and much is expected of you many, many times. And I think the reason that I'm in public service is because of that, because they made it clear to me that particularly those of us who were first-generation Americans had a special responsibility to give something back to this country, and it's why I'm in public life today.
How did this belief in yourself develop?
Well, my parents were very supportive, but they also were very proud of our background, our traditions, our culture, and yet they were fiercely American and very patriotic. They weren't political in an active sense, but they took their responsibilities as naturalized citizens very seriously. They always voted. The 6 o'clock news, because in those days we didn't have television when I was a kid, the 6 o'clock radio news was always on, and we sat and listened, and there was plenty of discussion around the table, and that sense of community and public service was a very strong element in my bringing up. My dad was a doctor, the first American-trained Greek-speaking doctor in metropolitan Boston, and a wonderful family doctor, and he conveyed that sense that there was nothing you could do in this life more fulfilling than being of service to others, and I grew up with that.
Reverend Jackson?
I was born to a teenage mother, but I was not forsaken by her. I was not abandoned by her. And she married my stepfather, who adopted me. And so I learned early on that children need love as a form of security more than they need material things. A second, I had this contrast between living in rather rough or slimy conditions, but having to make a judgment, that is, to use my mind to conquer matter and not let matter or the environment conquer me. Thus, I was born in the slum and grew up in the slum, but the slum did not grow up in me. they injected within me the will to win and the will to fight back. And finally, no matter what my ritual of difficulties may be, I never earned the right to do less than my best. Even being born under those conditions did not entitle me to do less than my best in school or to do less than my best relative to how I would treat or respect other people. I think the last dimension, of course, I was born in a segregated South under the laws of apartheid. And therefore, developing the capacity to understand the oppressed relationship and yet not become bitter, but to become better. Not become hateful, but to try to fight back rejection with love, became, in the final analysis, a weapon. And so I run this campaign full of optimism and hope, because I found that one of the great levers for development is to be hopeful against the odds.
Senator Gore.
Well, long before I was born, my mother was one of the first women to graduate from law school in Tennessee. My father served in the Congress for 10 years before I was born, and my childhood was filled with memories of both of them fighting battles for progress and developing in my sister and me a commitment to public service and the idea that we can make this a better country. I was intensely proud of him, for example, when he was one of only two Southern senators to refuse to sign the so-called Southern Manifesto after the Brown versus Board of Education decision. I was proud of his courage in leading the fight against the Vietnam War, even though that cost him his Senate seat in 1970. I became rather disillusioned with politics because of the Vietnam War, in which I went and served, and because of Watergate and a lot of developments during those times. And I only gradually rekindled my interest in public service as a reporter covering government and writing a series about corruption in government in Nashville and
some of that residual influence from childhood made you do that?
Well, I think that coming back to it on my own terms and seeing that it could be done better and feeling a commitment to try to make this a better country was undoubtedly related to my early childhood.
Before we get into a discussion of issues, gentlemen, let's discuss some of the politics of the moment. Reverend Jackson, Jim Wright, the Speaker of the House, said on Friday that if you arrive at the convention a close second to Michael Dukakis, you would have to be considered for the vice presidential nomination. Do you think if you fail to win but come in second, you should be on the ticket?
Well, I certainly would have earned serious consideration. But that's true for either of the three of us, because our mission really must be to expand the party, to heal the party, and those who've worked the hardest the last year to make the party strong, to give it a clear direction, for soon the burden of leadership ought to have the option to take our party to the White House in 1988.
Would you launch a third party candidacy if you finished first or second and they didn't give you a place?
Well, I do not have a pessimistic view of the party in that sense. I'm convinced that when the people will have spoken, the party is of the people, and it indeed will respond. In 1980, when Kennedy lost to Carter, he was a bit disillusioned, and he helped Carter with one or two speeches, but most of his people walked away. I said, no difference between Reagan and Carter. I didn't believe that, and I worked real hard. In 84, there were those who said, if I did not win, I would walk away. The fact is, I campaigned more miles than Ferraro and Mondale did in 84 and delivered. Therefore, we won four Senate seats against the odds. And in 86, we were able to put on 2 million new voters who turned the Senate back to Democrats. And so my object is, A, to strengthen the country, to strengthen the party, and thirdly, to play a role in determining our victory for 88.
Senator Gore, you had an observation?
Yeah, I wanted to comment on that. I don't think anybody should get the misunderstanding that we're not going to be totally unified in the fall. We are going to be unified. We've had more than 30 debates in this campaign, and we are absolutely convinced that George Bush cannot be president of the United States. We cannot continue this Reagan-Bush approach to government. Those of us who've been out here working and traveling all over this country and seeing the AIDS victims and seeing the homeless on the sidewalks, seeing the consequences of this terrible drug epidemic, and the people who have traded in high-paying jobs for minimum wage jobs, we are determined that we're going to have a unified party, and we are going to win in the fall. No question about that.
How would you feel about Mr. Jackson being on a ticket with you?
It's too early for me to pick my vice presidential nominee. I'm going to do that at the appropriate time. I'm not going to pick my cabinet yet either.
The electability issue. Politicians have raised the question of whether a black man can be elected.
Well, you know, this debate has been on the issues. And some people would have said Jesse Jackson couldn't carry Michigan. But he did. And so who is to say, least of all Mike or me, that Jesse Jackson is not electable? I've never said that either Jesse or Mike is not electable. Let me say this. I think that it's going to be a close, hard-fought contest in the fall. And I think the balance of power in the Electoral College has in the past been held disproportionately by independent voters in a number of states who are willing to go one way or the other. One of the things I've said in this campaign is I think we have to reach out to those voters, and we have to emphasize traditional Democratic approaches on economic growth and social justice.
Okay, we'll get to that.
Strong American role in the world.
Get to that a little later, Governor.
Yeah, let me just add to this that I think there's a very broad consensus in this country, both within the Democratic Party and across the country, about what we need. People want a change in this country. They want a president that's going to provide active leadership for economic growth, for jobs, for health care, for housing. They want a president who can lead us internationally.
What about this electability issue?
Well, it's an issue, I think. People on Tuesday, I hope in New York, will take a look at the three of us and decide which one of us is the strongest nominee, who can beat George Bush, can be the best president. Obviously, that's...
Well, how do you feel?
Well,
Is a black man as electable as a white person?
I don't think race is a factor here. I come from a state that elected and re-elected a black man in the United States Senate.
You'd be willing to have Jesse Jackson on your ticket?
I wouldn't rule anybody out or in at this point.
Yeah.
Obviously, I want to win this nomination, but I don't think that's an issue. I think it's the question really is which one of us would be the strongest nominee and the best president.
I think the real point is that Mike and I came over here on different boats. He came over here on the immigrant boat. I came over here on a slave boat, but we're in the same boat now, and I intend to be the captain of the ship.
And I'll be the admiral.
should the person with the most delegates get this nomination, that is, even if it's only a plurality, or does it have to be a majority, as you see it?
It's obvious whoever has less than 51% must negotiate a relationship to, in fact, have broad enough support to be able to win. And I am convinced that we're going to have to use our cumulative strength to win. Kennedy beat Nixon by 112,000 votes. On our best day, we won by less than one vote per precinct. Humphrey lost to Nixon by 550,000. So whatever the combination is finally, our cumulative strength and maximum unity will be required to win.
Now,
Gabe, I would say this. I think George Bush is eminently beatable. I don't think there's any question about that. If we nominate the right ticket, if we go to work together, if we take these important issues to the people of this country, and I think all three of us believe that, believe it very strongly.
You know, you ought to raise the electability.
But
I make a point?
Yeah, right.
You ought to raise the electability issue where George Bush is concerned. I don't think he is electable.
But what Reverend Jackson has been saying is that there has to be a negotiated agreement, since nobody's going to have a clear 51%.
If it comes down to that, the point is that we should, A, not have the notion, the attitude of if I do not win, take my marbles and go home. That would be a bad attitude. In the final analysis, one person will win, a ticket will be formed, and a direction will be made clear. After that point, Bush is then running on the track where he has to try to defend the veto of the Civil Rights Restoration Act. He has to defend this budget deficit. He has to defend the South African policy. Bush has to defend the Noriega drug trafficking CIA relationship. And once that field is really established, George Bush is not electable.
And don't forget that he was sitting right in the Oval Office when they made the proposal to send that birthday cake to the Ayatollah and propose a swap of weapons for hostages. But back to your question, the rules provide that the winner has to have a majority of the delegates, and the rules haven't been changed. That is the way the nominee will be chosen. But the point is, nobody should underestimate one thing. We are going to be unified. The party is going to be unified. Democrats, independents, and a lot of disillusioned Republicans are hungry for a victory.
And you all agree on that. That's clear. And just one last question. Reverend Jackson, this question has been posed many times about you, but I want to ask it about somebody else. What do you think that Al Gore really wants?
Well, I really think
the nomination.
He really wants the nomination. He'll have to adjust to not having it, but he really wants it.
We'll be back to
maybe
talk
not.
About some,
maybe not.
Some
don't
issues.
Don't lick your chops too soon.
We'll be back to talk about some issues after this.
Didn't mean that.
What about this question of the cities? Let's get very specific about it. What would you do for a place like New York City? How do you, let's change that question. What do you offer Governor Dukakis that your two opponents don't offer in terms of help for these wretched older cities?
Well, I'm a doer, not just a talker, Gabe. I mean, I've worked hard with my cities. I am very strongly committed to people who live in urban communities as well as smaller towns and rural counties, and I'm very proud of what I've done in job creation, in the building of urban economies, of creating healthy downtowns, a strong job base. I invest in mass transit. We're building housing for families of low and moderate income, providing health care for working families. Those are the things that every city, not just New York City, every city needs. And if we're going to build a strong economy in this country and provide opportunity for our citizens, that's what we have to do.
Low-income housing. I think both the Reverend Jackson and Senator Gore have said that they want to invest like $32 billion in that, and you haven't given a figure.
No, I'm not sure they want to invest $32 billion at a time.
Can I respond to that?
Well, let me say this.
Reverend Jackson had his hand up first,
then
we'll go to you, Senator.
What we're doing in my state, and other people are doing across the country, is creating partnerships where builders, developers, building trade unions, state and local governments, nonprofit organizations.
And that's what you'd like to do on a national basis?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
In a real sense, with the 86 tax bill on the one hand, the deficit on the other, there's hardly any money left to invest in affordable housing. Therefore, I came up with a concept and met with some investment bankers, some pension fund holders on a way to take about 10% of public pension funds, which would be about $60 billion over a 10-year period, government secured, fair rate of return guaranteed, labor business management on the board, and leverage that money in partnership with cities. New York City is the number one slum landlord in New York. There are vacant properties. There are boarded properties. There are people living double and tripled. We, in fact, have the expertise in this city in partnership to build affordable housing. The pension fund money is on the one hand, government secured, land made available, the state's given tax breaks. We must have a plan to build affordable housing, not just wish for them.
Why is your idea or your ideas in the city area, why are they better than your opponents?
Well, I'm not sure better is the point, is my idea has been one that is feasible. And it has been agreed upon by people who deal in investment banking and who hold pension funds. It is a way. In other words, you can't just hope for better housing, which all of us hope for. There must be some way to identify the money to do it. In New York, as federal leader, I would not be spending $250 million in New York to home port a ship carrying nuclear weapons and ask the city to be a partner in that ship. I would use that money to help rebuild the Williamsburg Bridge so people can move back and forth. So it does mean a shifting in priorities. I choose to invest in bridges that work. That's how you put iron workers, steel workers, painters, engineers, and inspect us back to work, and without the security, the risk of home port.
Yeah, if I could address the same question, I don't want to let Mike's comment stand about being a doer, not a talker. For 12 years, I have fought for cities in the United States Congress, in the United States Senate. I was there years ago as the leading sponsor of legislation to help the homeless, for example, at a time when the only other senator who would co-sponsor it was Pat Moynihan. I've been leading the fight to address the problems of the homeless. I've been a leader in the fight to combat the AIDS epidemic. We've got to recognize that the urban agenda now includes homelessness, AIDS, a war against drugs, mass transit. We've also got to address the economic
problems. Why do you think your program for the cities is superior to those programs of your opponents?
Well, I think I've been working on it longer in a broader dimension from the national level. Because, I mean, I have respect for both of my opponents and their agendas. And I just think that in 12 years' experience in the Senate and the House, I've had an opportunity to deal with this agenda in great detail.
Gabe, I have identified for debate and discussion a plan to identify the money with partnership with the city and the state to build the affordable housing. Homelessness is a crisis in part because Reagan cut the housing and urban development budget back from $32 billion to less than $10 billion. So you have, on the one hand, Trump Towers going up with all the luxury and splendor, and around it, all of the squalor and poverty. But at some point in time, we must be able to identify the money to be a part of the partnership.
How do you feel about that idea?
Well, we're already doing it, Gabe. In my state and other states, we're using state pension funds. We're working with our building trade unions so that they use their pension funds for this purpose, and it works terrifically well. I've got a bricklayers union in my state that has organized a nonprofit housing subsidiary with our help.
Did you see doing that on a national
basis? Absolutely. But the difference is that a president makes it happen. A president has to bring people together, has to build these partnerships. And that's the kind of thing a chief executive does. I've been doing that. And that's what I want to do in Washington.
Let's talk about the AIDS problem for just a moment, the crisis, which has such staggering dimensions. There are at least four major aspects: education, testing, counseling, drugs, and, of course, public support for research.
Research to find a cure.
Right. Where do we start education?
We started in the earliest grades in school.
Absolutely.
In appropriate
ways. You all agree
ways.
On that?
Absolutely.
Right.
See Everett Koop. You know, there's a kind of a misunderstanding that somehow young children are not prepared to hear about these subjects. There are appropriate ways to begin the educational process in the earliest grades in school. Dr. Koop has shown materials to illustrate how even in the first grade you can begin to get some basic concepts.
Would you distribute?
In this instance, you need to start with the White House, not with the schoolhouse, because the lack of initiative to address the AIDS crisis, the sense of peddling hysteria, is coming from the highest levels of government. That's why we move so slow on addressing the crisis. Those who take AIDS tests, the test should be confidential. The test ought to be available. The test ought to be free.
You're against mandatory testing.
I am. And see what
and you are too, Governor.
What leadership must do is to set climate. That's just idea of bully pulpit. In other words, 600,000 gays and lesbians and other people marched in Washington October the 11th, crying out for help, really crying out for a sense of mercy, for human understanding. And I stood with them because by embracing people who have AIDS, you say by definition you don't catch AIDS by embracing people, by shaking their hands.
Can I make a brief point on this? I took the trouble of getting the latest information on this. There are three boroughs in New York City, which, if they were states, would be in the top 10 states in the number of cases of AIDS. This is a national crisis. It is one that must receive particular attention here in New York. There are now 59,287 cases of AIDS in the United States, and 13,752 here in New York City. We've got to have research to speed up a cure. We have got to have a comprehensive education and prevention campaign.
What about distributing sterile needles, an experimental program that started here in New York? Are you in favor of that?
I personally am not for that, but because...
To drug addicts, right.
I personally am not for that, but because Dr. Koop and some other experts have recommended that it be tried on a pilot basis, I think we have an obligation to evaluate it more closely. I'm personally not for it, though.
Governor?
No, I don't favor it. I think methadone maintenance, I think an opportunity to get treatment. No drug addict, no chemically dependent person, Gabe, in this country, ever should be turned away from the opportunity to rid himself or herself of that addiction.
But there's a big backlog of people who can't get treatment.
Well, but it's a question of choice, isn't it? I mean, where do we spend our money? Where do we put our resources? Is it going to go into Star Wars?
If that becomes the real point, I mean, that every heroin addict, the average, if they steal $33,000 worth of goods and services, plus take lives every year.
Are you for distributing sterile needles?
Well, I resist it very much because it's like surrendering to the war. There's a big debate about it now. I basically am not willing at this point to surrender to the drug war. I thought Al was going to mention this, that this is the first time, the data's now breaking, that more people are catching AIDS through needle or drug transmission than through sexual.
That's the fastest growing avenue of transmission.
Can
I come back to one thing? Mike, you just said that it's a question of priorities and where you're willing to spend the money.
Right.
But in the last 2 days, twice you have said publicly that if you were elected president, you would not increase the money spent in the war against drugs at all.
I didn't say that, Al. Well, what I said was that thanks to you and your colleagues, we're getting the resources at the state and local level to fight a war against drugs. The problem is we have an administration, as you know, that keeps backing and filling on the issue. First proposes it, the president signs the bill, takes credit for it, then decides he wants to cut it. Speaking as a governor, I can tell you that in my state, thanks to the Congress, we're getting resources now to bring comprehensive drug and health education into the early elementary grades.
You're not saying it's adequate, are you? Yeah.
I'm not saying it's adequate, but what I'm saying is that at this point, we're getting resources, and I don't know that they're being used.
But wait a minute. Let me make this point, because both the Newsday and the U.S. and the Daily News have both reported the same statement, that the funds appropriated now by Congress are probably enough to get started. It's not an effort that requires massive resources.
I said it's enough to get started, and I mean it. And
says
I
said you would not dedicate significant new federal funding to the effort.
I speak as a governor whose state is committing state resources, and I believe the states have to commit resources here. This isn't just a national problem. And thanks to you and your colleagues, we're getting additional resources
Dedicate new funding to it?
I would first organize the 50 governors and get them going, Al, on the kind of comprehensive drug prevention
education. But wait a minute. This is a major crisis. The drug crisis deserves more attention.
Well, it deserves
attention. Would you dedicate new federal funding to the war against drugs?
That depends on the kind of effort we put together and whether or not
I think you've answered the question.
Well, throwing money at the
problem. I don't think he has answered the question.
Throwing money at the problem by itself doesn't do it. You've got to have a president who knows how to do it.
I can't say that I would.
You haven't.
Let me say
Reverend
that
Jackson, very short observation.
I put
forth a budget to increase funding, A, to stop drug flow at the source, to strengthen our borders, but also rehabilitation. People in this city, or in this state, who admit that they are on drugs and want to get well, often have to wait 6 and 8 months for rehabilitation treatment. We do need more money now because drug flow, drug consumption, drug sickness is an emergency. It is the number one threat to our national security, number one cause of crime on the streets of the state.
We'll be back to discuss some foreign policy issues after this. On foreign policy and other concerns, Governor, you're the President of the United States now. It's 3:00 in the morning. You're informed that the Soviet Union has invaded Western Europe. The NATO commander is asking for permission to use tactical nuclear weapons as the army moves on. What are your options?
Our options are NATO policy, to use conventional forces, but to reserve the right to use nuclear forces if we have to. But our principal purpose, Gabe, has to be to prevent war. And the way you do that is by convincing your adversaries not to start war in the first place. That's what nuclear deterrence is all about. That's what NATO policy and U.S. policy is all about. But we have a series of options, and obviously, those are options that have to be considered at the time something like that happens. There's no way you can tell in advance precisely what you're going to do, and you shouldn't do that.
What would you do if you were President Jackson?
You must know that you're asking to give the general permission to end the world. In the real sense, nuclear weapons as a deterrent, yes. To use them is to invite a response. First retaliation, I mean first use, first retaliation, and since first strike, first retaliation. That's why Mike is essentially right. We must move now before we get to a 3:00 in the morning call to reduce the nuclear weapons, support the INF agreement, go to Moscow, indeed as Mr. Reagan is finally doing, to support deeper cuts that are mutually verifiable. In Europe right now, first, there's not likely to be a war, in part because there are 200 nuclear power stations in the area, and even a conventional war will in fact be a nuclear war, and it's an unwinnable war. So we should not keep inciting the American public that we're just one step away from pulling the trigger. We must not be that close to mutual annihilation.
So Your answer to the question is that it's not going to come up.
Well, that's right, because I'm going to make certain that, the afternoon before 3 o'clock in the morning, I had the kind of thrust going for mutual security in the area that would, in fact, eliminate the likelihood.
Senator.
Well, the way to keep it from coming up is to maintain the uncertainty in the minds of Soviet leaders about what our response would be. And NATO policy and the United States policy is not, as it has been stated. There are two policies. First of all, forward defense, which means we would not allow them to overrun West Germany and take West Germany before there was an effective military response. And secondly, the policy of flexible response, which is deliberately ambiguous. It's difficult and complicated to talk about in public, but basically what it means is we're not going to tell the Soviet Union in advance exactly what we would do if they invaded Western Europe. And I'm not going to say in advance what we would do.
And they're not going to tell us. And so here both of us live as superpowers in a rather uncivilized posture, being one step away from mutual destruction, mutual annihilation.
But we don't improve that particular situation by telling them specifically in advance what we would do in this situation. We improve it by pursuing arms control and by taking advantage of what could be a genuinely historic opportunity. That was Mike's point in the first place.
And all of us agree on that. The real challenge for the next president is to take advantage of that opportunity, to go beyond the INF agreement, to negotiate deep cuts in strategic weapons, to negotiate a test ban treaty, to get going, Gabe, on negotiations leading to the reduction of conventional forces in Europe with deeper cuts on the Soviet side. And I don't believe any president in our lifetime will have the opportunity the next president will have to do that.
Okay, I withdraw the question. South Africa, you've discussed the situation in terms of sanctions. If South Africa refuses to change, would you sever relations with that country, Reverend Jackson?
That's not the approach. I believe that you have to talk with your enemies to neutralize them and ultimately change them. But how do you change South Africa? You must see South Africa is not a state, it is a region. It is an octopus with tentacles that go as far north as Cape Gabenda in northern Angola. So we start by meeting with the leaders of the region, a summit meeting involved in a regional approach to ending apartheid's power. That certainly involves getting South Africa out of Angola and out of Namibia. At that time, you can get Cuba out of Angola. You cut the Angolan leg off of South Africa's power. In Namibia, a free election, and Swapo will win. In Mozambique, you support the Beira Corridor, open up the Beira Corridor out of Mozambique and Limpopo Railroad. Zimbabwe and Zambia will then be freed up. If you cut that much territory away from South Africa and free Zimbabwe and Zambia from having to trade through South Africa, that's a severe boycott. With that, you add American corporations by a date certain, unless they're open, free, and fair elections, must be ordered to leave South Africa. That will end that regime, but it will get us to the table short of bloodshed, and that ought to be the objective.
Governor, what are your thoughts about severing relations with them if all else fails?
I wouldn't sever relations, but we've got to be prepared to impose some very tough economic sanctions on South Africa, okay, in concert, preferably, with the international community, because that's the way economic sanctions work. That may not, strictly speaking, be a severing of relations, but it's going to be very, very tough, and it has to be if the white power structure in South Africa is going to be persuaded that what they're doing is leading inevitably to bloody tragedy and a catastrophe. I'm very proud of the fact that my state was the first state in the country to divest its pension investments from South Africa, but this needs more than that. This needs international action.
On a personal level, Governor, you divested your investments about 2 years ago, or your own family's. Is that correct?
Well, I think it was about a year ago, yeah.
So, in a sense, that was too long, perhaps, in terms of your national policy. I acted on it and did it, and
perhaps should have done it earlier, to tell you the truth. But
Senator, what about breaking relations with South Africa?
Well, you know, even this administration maintains relations with the Sandinista government in Nicaragua because they feel that there is a way to utilize dialogue. Of course, I disagree totally with their approach down there, but the point is this. There are reasons for maintaining a dialogue even when you strongly disagree. I think we have to emphasize economic sanctions. I've consistently voted for the strongest available sanctions against the South African government. And I think we're getting very close to the point where we're going to have to go all the way and say that all U.S. investment has to be pulled back. We're not quite there yet, but I think we're getting very close to that point. I think we also have to give economic assistance to the frontline nations. Now, I think we have a disagreement about military aid. I don't think that it's useful to extend, to give weapons to the frontline states or to the ANC. At this point, I think that would be inviting a lot more bloodshed.
How could you stand on the bar and have frontline states, which are sovereign states and allies, and offer them aid as we did Europe, and not offer them the defensive weapons to protect themselves from South Africa's blowing up of the infrastructure? Well, it would not have made sense for us to put a Marshall Plan in Europe, then not protect Europe from an invasion that could undercut the investment. So frontline states in Southern Africa deserve what frontline states in Western Europe got.
Would you give weapons to the ANC?
Not necessarily, but the frontline states, and that is a difference.
Well, but in both cases, this is legitimate.
It is not one and the same. Tanzania, Zambia, Zimbabwe, Mozambique, the frontline states, in fact, ought to be able to defend themselves from South Africa's bombarding of their infrastructure and our investment.
Let me respond, because this is a legitimate debate here. I don't disagree with the principle that they ought to be able to defend themselves. I just think that the situation there is so volatile right now that we might really be inviting a quantum increase in the bloodshed in that region if we threw gasoline on the fire by putting a lot more weapons in the region at this time.
We offer our allies weapons to defend themselves if they indeed are our allies, and frontline states indeed are our allies. Okay. We should not throw them to the wind.
We haven't
assume that somehow here is a government that is in fact official terrorist by definition. We would not offer our allies in Africa the same support we offer our allies in Europe. That's inconsistent.
Governor Dukakis wants to get a word in edgewise. Go ahead, Governor.
I would say this. I think the superpowers are supplying arms to too many countries as it is. What's needed here is strong international action by the international community led by the United States. If that happened, then I don't think we'd be having to supply arms to the frontline states or anyone else. But it hasn't happened. And it's one of the reasons why today South Africa seems to operate with impunity.
Well, then what would we do if our allies are supplying arms to South Africa? What would we do to them? What would we do to them?
Well, obviously, Jesse, we ought to be doing everything we can to stop them from doing that.
We ought to enforce the international boycott that already exists against any shipment of arms to South Africa. We honor that. And if an ally does ship arms to South Africa, what would we do to the ally? I personally think there ought to be sanctions against countries
that send
weapons to South Africa.
The point is the international community has to take action, and the United States is leading that.
We're running out of time for this segment. We'll be back after this.
You know you would have.
Reverend Jackson, Hymetown, your association in the past with Reverend Farrakhan, who denounced Judaism as a gutter religion. Do you understand why some Jews still regard you with suspicion, wondering whether the past is still part of you?
I do. And that is why I also understand that people have to forgive each other and redeem each other and move on. Obviously, some people feel that way. And that is why when...
You feel like a sinner who has to be redeemed?
Well, it is important that we admit the errors of our ways and become better people. And Reagan went to Bitburg to lay a wreath. I went to Stroganoff concentration camp to stand with Bruno Kreisky. He was sending a message, but the right thing to do. And Reagan went to Geneva to only discuss the arms negotiations. I challenged Gorbachev before the whole world on the question of Soviet Jewry and human rights, because the absence of weapons is not the presence of human rights. A few weeks ago, Elizabeth Holtzman, founder of the Loris Brunner, a Nazi war criminal, was in Syria. She could not ask anyone else that she knew to seek his extradition, but I did, because I could contact Assad in Syria.
You haven't heard from him yet, President Assad?
I have not.
Do you intend to renew that request?
Well, indeed. Matter of fact, I have sent a letter just today, as a matter of fact, renewing that request. The real point is that in the course of our relationships, We have to have the capacity, it seems to me, to look at what we have in common. You know, just last week, 13 white supremacists in Arkansas were acquitted, aimed directly at blacks and Jews, and that is why the sons and daughters of the Holocaust and grandsons and granddaughters of slavery must rise above any impediment to get stronger, and no leader who's responsible will keep injuring those wounds in public and make healing less likely.
Why have you refused to meet with the two major Jewish groups?
I have met with a cross-section of leadership, and I've had to make a judgment about who to meet with and when. In this city, for example, I have to respect many groups. One of my first endorsements was Barry Feinstein of the Teamsters, and then I met with a group of business leaders led by Peter and Ellen Strauss, and then met with the publishers. I've been endorsed by The Nation, by Village Voice. But I submit this to you, I've also had to meet with Haitian leadership in this city. I've also had to meet with Caribbean leadership in this city. I've also had to meet with African-American leadership and with Irish leadership concerned about Northern Ireland and Italian leadership. My campaign, Gabe, is the most diverse, the most multicultural, and I will keep reaching out to everybody. Look at the structure of my staff. Look at the structure of my campaign. You will see in that campaign staff a broad cross-section of people sitting there affirms participation by Jewish people at a significant level.
On Israel, Governor Dukakis, you are not for a Palestinian state, nor are you against it. You believe further negotiation should determine that, whereas the Reverend Jackson is for it and Senator Gore is against it.
I think that's up to Israel and its neighbors, Gabe. As a practical matter, if Israel and or Jordan or both don't want an independent Palestinian state, it isn't going to happen. I see the role of the President of the United States beginning in 1989 as being one where he provides leadership to persuade Arab leaders to stand up and do what Sadat did in 1979, and that is to say, yes, the people of Israel have a right to exist in dignity and freedom in their country.
Should the Palestinian state issue be in the platform of the Democratic Party?
Should it be in the platform? Mm-hmm. Well, I would like a platform which emphasizes the importance of direct negotiations between Israel and its neighbors. And that's the first and most important task that the President of the United States is going to have.
Well, first on the platform question, I think we're likely to have a broader and more general and shorter platform than we have had in the past. But let me address the question that's on the table here. I'm opposed to a Palestinian state because traditionally independent nations have the right to arm themselves and to strike alliances with whomever they wish. And the nearness of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip to Tel Aviv and Jerusalem and the most vulnerable point in Israel is such that I really do think it would be like a dagger pointed at Israel's heart. I support the peace process. I support the formula of land for peace in the Camp David agreements. And I disagree with Prime Minister Shamir in believing that it does apply to the West Bank and Gaza, or at least portions thereof. And the process could have a novel outcome that changed the status of the West Bank and Gaza on terms that did not enhance the security threat to Israel.
You know, yesterday, 13 more Palestinians were killed. There must be a sense of humanity in our consideration about the present situation, where Israel and the Palestinians are trapped in a death grip, in a cycle of death. Occupation gave us too great a burden to bear. Emotionally, it's draining. Politically, it's very divisive. Economically, it's inflationary and costly, and you can't grow. And militarily, it is too bloody. We must do a hard thing. A, ensure Israel's security, secure borders. We cannot ensure tranquility, because tranquility and occupation do not go hand in hand. So what we must do is have the freedom, certainly to an international conference, to convince Israel's adversaries and Israel to move away from this cycle of murder and bloodshed to mutual recognition and land for peace.
Are you for an international conference, Governor?
I'm for anything that will lead to direct negotiations between Israel and its neighbors and responsible Palestinian leaders.
What about you?
I'm not opposed to an international conference, but I'm not in favor of the kind of conference that has now been proposed for this reason. It contains China, which has just sold missiles to Saudi Arabia, Russia, whose motives are at best unclear, and five Arab nations in addition to Israel, and it's supposed to
to convene for the entire duration of the direct negotiations. And I think we've got to re-examine that particular
architecture. Okay, we'll be back. We'll be back after this. Gentlemen, closing statements. We have about 50 seconds for each of you. A last word to the voters. Senator Gore.
Well, thank you very much, Gabe. I've enjoyed this discussion. It wasn't really a debate. It was a very useful discussion of issues important to this country. And this election is one of the most important we have ever faced. I'm working to put the White House back on the side of working men and women. I believe that can be done if we defeat George Bush in November, and we're going to accomplish that. There is one simple question that is most important as you think about who to vote for this Tuesday. Who among the three of us can do the best job in the Oval Office? Who has the experience? Who has the leadership? Who can pursue economic growth, social justice, and an intelligent role for this nation? Vote on the basis of your hope, not your fears. Cast a positive vote for Al Gore.
Thank you, Senator. Governor Dukakis.
The people of New York will have an opportunity on Tuesday to shape history. And you're going to face a fundamental choice. Which one of the three of us will be our strongest nominee?